this is Shadow the Rat, and in honor of World Rat Day, which is today, I'm going to be redoing my Rat Care 101 video. So before we get started, I think it's really important to impress upon anyone watching just how important it is for rats to have a cage mate. Rats are very social animals, and keeping them alone can be quite damaging to their psychology. Not only do rats groom and sleep together, but they also enjoy playing together, eating together, and just being together. Overall, keeping rats alone really isn't fair on them, and with the exception of a very few cases where the rat's poor genetics inclines them to incurable rat-on-rat aggression, they really shouldn't be kept alone. Keep in mind that not all rat introductions will be easy, and some rats will need extra help to bond to their new cage mates. Sometimes this even includes things like neutering in the case of hormonal males, or doing things like multiple intros or the carrier method in order to get the rats to bond. Once bonded though, they will really benefit a ton from their fellow rats, and this really makes it worth all the effort. I won't be discussing how to bond new rats in this video, however I will link a few videos I've done on the topic in the description down below. As a little bit of a side note, be aware that rats do play fight a lot. You can expect to see a lot of wrestling and mock fighting, especially when your rats are younger. These behaviors are all normal for a bonded pair or group of rats, and you shouldn't prevent them from happening. As long as no rat is scared of the others and no one is getting hurt, then it's best to just let dominant squabbles play out and resolve on their own. Now with that out of the way, I want to go ahead and get started on the more detailed aspects of rat care. To start off, I would like to talk about suitable rat cages. Rats are fairly large and energetic small animals, and as such, they really need a large cage in order to really thrive. In addition to this, they have a sensitive respiratory system, which leaves them prone to respiratory infections. Because of this, any suitable rat cage is going to need a lot of ventilation, including at least two sides that are fully ventilated and a top that is fully ventilated. Now, you can make your own cage from suitable materials, such as a plastic bin and hardware cloth, or something like wood. But keep in mind that many of these materials can soak up urine and will need to either be coated with a rat-safe finish or powder-coated in the case of wire in order to prevent them from absorbing urine and stinking. Because, let's be honest, no one wants a stinky rat cage. As mentioned before, rat cages also need to be quite large, with most rat owners agreeing that 2.5 cubic feet is the minimum for the first rat, and you'll need an additional 2 to 2.5 cubic feet for each additional rat. And again, rats do need to be kept in pairs or groups, so going with the minimum for one rat is never advisable. In fact, if you can, it's better to go well above the minimum. There really isn't a maximum here, and the more space and the better you utilize the space, the better. Rats are really intelligent and agile little creatures, and so they benefit from a lot of room to run around, along with a lot of toys to engage with. This also means that it's really important for your cage to have a good sized base, as while rats do enjoy climbing, they are actually natural ground dwelling creatures. And this means that they really need the space to be able to run around, and they're also natural burrowers, which means it's really nice to give them an option to burrow as well. Rat cages should also have bar spacing of 1/2 inch at most, and this is because young rats and small adult rats can easily slip out of bar spacings that are 3/4 inch to 1 inch, which is something you can find with larger cages meant for larger animals like ferrets or rabbits. And you can actually fix these cages with something known as hardware cloth, which you would zip tie onto the cage itself. Hardware cloth is a metal mesh, and you can buy it at most hardware stores. However, it's a pain to work with, and if you haven't bought your cage yet, I highly suggest you go ahead and look for a cage with smaller bar spacing, just so you don't have to modify it. As for suitable cage examples, that will heavily depend on where you live. For example, I live in the United States, and here the Critter Nation is considered one of the best rat cages out there, and that's because it has 1/2 inch bar spacing along with fully opening doors, which allows you to easily clean the cage, easily have rat access, and of course the bar spacing means that you can have rats of any age in there. Now, a single Critter Nation can house up to 4 to 6 rats, and a double can house up to 10 to 12 rats, and there is an add-on for this cage as well, which is the size of a single Critter Nation. And this means that each time you add another unit, you will be able to house up to 4 to 6 more rats in the cage. Keep in mind that even if you have a smaller group of rats, they can still enjoy these really large cages, and in fact, it's not uncommon for people to keep pairs or even small groups of rats in large cages like the Double Critter Nation. Other good cages in the US include the Katie My First Home multi-level for exotics, which is good for 2 to 4 rats, the Rat Manor, which works for 2 to 3 rats, the Prevu Rat and Chinchilla Cage, which is good for 4 to 6 rats, the PetSmart Rat Starter Kit, which is good for 2 to 4 rats, and finally also Martin Cages, along with a variety of other cages. Cages outside the U.S. that are considered ideal include things like the U.K. Liberta Explora, the European Sevec Royal Suite, the Australian Ferret Kingdom, and many more. Keep in mind that these are just a few examples, and there are lots of other suitable rat cages, including repurposed cages for other animals such as birds. I suggest that when looking for a rat cage that you first consider any downsides such as small doors, plastic bases, large bar spacing, and low pans, along with consider how many rats it can comfortably house before purchasing it. Another option is to buy a used cage off somewhere like Craigslist or Facebook Marketplace, or to make your own cage from something like a bin and hardware cloth. I will link the mentioned commercial cages down below in the description, along with add a link to my video on how to build a bin cage. Now let's move on to substrate. Substrate is the stuff that will cover your rat's cage and absorb your rat's waste. You can either use loose bedding or fleece for this, and my preferred substrate is a bedding called Yesterday's News. Yesterday's News is a pelleted cat litter with excellent odor control, and has the added benefit of being heavy enough that the rats can't easily kick it out and make a mess. Other good beddings include kiln-dried pine, aspen chips, and other pelleted beddings. Avoid any softwood bedding that isn't kiln-dried, as these tend to release phenols that can irritate the rat's already sensitive respiratory systems. Also keep in mind that paper bedding alone, such as Carefresh, isn't great for odor control, and also tends to be rather dusty. This means that if you plan on using it, you'll probably need to mix it with another bedding for it to be effective, or use it solely for something such as a dig box. I myself use crinkled paper in my rat's dig tank to allow them to exhibit some natural burrowing behaviors, in a bedding that tends to hold its shape pretty well. However, since this is paper, it doesn't absorb or neutralize urine very well, so you can do something like that if you want to use paper bedding, where you use it in your dig tank or as just further enrichment, and you use a different bedding in your rat's litter boxes or in their pans. On the other hand, if you plan on using fleece, you will need to do a little bit more maintenance. To start with, you'll need to be sure to use an underpad under the fleece, such as a U-Haul pad, to absorb the urine. The whole point of fleece is for it to be placed above an absorbent layer, so that when your rat pees on it, the urine percolates through the fleece and into the absorbent underpad. You'll want to avoid things like towels, because these can have strings which can get tangled around your rat's feet, especially if they chew up the fleece and towel, because that unfortunately can happen in a lot of cases. And you also want to avoid things like puppy pads, because if your rats chew them and ingest them, they could potentially poison your rats. It's also a good idea to litter train your rats if you plan on using fleece, and this can be done by placing small containers with your chosen bedding in a large rock on each level, and placing the rat's feces into it whenever you spot clean, until they are using them consistently. Keep in mind that if you do choose to use fleece, you will also want to give your rats an option to dig and kind of show some of those natural behaviors, and so it's a good idea to give them some sort of loose bedding in a dig box so they can really show these natural behaviors. As with the cages above, I'm going to add some links down in my description to my preferred bedding in case anyone wants to check it out. Now I'm going to move on to cage maintenance and how often you need to clean the cage. This is going to depend more on your situation than anything else, as how often you need to clean greatly depends on many variables like what cage you have, how many rats it houses, what substrate you use, and even what you feed your rats. My current cage is a triple critter nation with 7 female rats living in it, and it only needs to be fully cleaned every 2.5 to 3 weeks. Keep in mind that if you are using something like fleece as your substrate, then you will probably have to clean the cage more often, possibly every 2 to 3 days, so it's a good idea to have spare fleece covers to use while washing the dirty ones. In my case, I do spot clean my cage every few days, and this involves me replacing dirty nesting material, spraying and wiping down the cage bars, wiping down the wheels, and changing my rat's food and water. For my full clean, on the other hand, I actually remove all of the bedding and toys, then wash the cage with water and wipe it down with Nature's Miracle. After it dries, I add in bedding, toys, food, and water. During this cleaning time, I keep my rats in one of my smaller cages, and as soon as I'm done, I replace the rats and then clean any remaining dirty toys in the sink. As for toys, there are quite a few toy options out there. One good choice that's both cheap and plentiful is cardboard boxes. Rats love chewing on cardboard, and while they don't technically have to chew to keep their incisors trim, it's still a fun activity that a lot of rats may enjoy. Other options for cheap rat toys include Dollar Tree baskets, using old clothes or felt to make DIY hammocks, using clean milk cartons as houses, using old storage bins or tanks filled with paper bedding or dirt as dig boxes, and so forth. Of course, you can also buy commercial toys for rats, and some of the best commercial toys that I've found include things that are difficult to make, like a good 12 to 16 inch wheel, certain bird foraging toys, including foraging wheels and treat balls, and certain sturdy houses like space pods and plastic igloos. Avoid buying too many wood toys, as while these can be cute and fun for your rats to chew on, they tend to get smelly really fast and can be hard to clean. Also keep in mind that many toys marketed for rats are actually unsafe for them, so it's always a good idea to do your research on any new toy first. Some toys to avoid would be things like snack shacks, which are made of flavored sawdust and wood and potentially can cause impactions if your rat decides to eat them, along with things like mineral licks or salt licks, which can be dangerous if the rat ingests too much. And you also want to avoid things like wire wheels, which can potentially damage your rat's feet if they run on them and their feet get stuck. And on top of that, avoid things like hamster balls, which are unfortunately not suitable for rats or really any rodent to run inside. They have small little ventilation holes, which are just not large enough to actually ventilate the ball. And on top of that, these holes can actually catch the rat's toes really easily and injure them. Plus, they force the rats to walk around in their own pee and poop all the time as they're running around. All in all, these balls are just really terrible things, and if you're going to use one, you should be using it inside the cage where it's hung up as a hammock, and not as something the rat explores in. I will link a few of my videos on good commercial and DIY toys below, along with add some links to the commercial toys mentioned in this video. Now the next thing I want to talk about is what you should feed your rats as their main diet. In my opinion, the easiest and safest rat food for most owners is a good lab block. Lab blocks are just ground up food that has been specifically tailored to meet rats' nutritional needs and then molded into blocks or triangles for easy consumption. Lab blocks prevent your rat from overeating, and they also prevent nutritional deficiencies in your rats. They remove the ability for your rats to pick and choose only certain foods, which can be an issue with seed mixes. With that being said, not all lab blocks are equal. Because of this, I recommend that if you choose to use lab blocks, you either use Oxbow Adult Rat Food, Envigo, or Missouri. Keep in mind that these are the best lab blocks in the US, and if you live elsewhere, chances are there is another nutritional complete lab block that is cheaper to use than importing one of the above brands. For example, in the UK, Science Selective is a comparable lab block to Oxbow, but will cost way less because you don't have to import it. I do want to make a note here about Oxbow, because Oxbow is one of those lab blocks that has a specific formula for younger rats and a different formula for rats over 6 months. And while in some cases this difference might be important, in the case of rats it's really not, and the only main difference other than the adult rat version having a better filler is that the young rat version has more protein in it. So most people that feed their rats Oxbow decide to just feed their rats the adult version and supplement a bit of extra protein for rats under 3 months. You can do this by adding some boiled eggs or scrambled eggs or cooked beans or a little bit of meat. Just something with a little bit of extra protein that you can give them on a weekly basis until they're over 3 months old. Your other option if you don't want to feed lab blocks is to feed a good seed mix. Seed mixes add more variety to your rat's diet, however, they also allow your rats to pick and choose. Because of this, it's important to only use a high quality seed mix and to scatter feed it by sprinkling it about the cage. You may also only want to feed a certain amount depending on your rat's body weight to prevent them from overeating. Keep in mind that most commercial seed mixes are pretty bad nutritional wise, so if you do go this route, I recommend making your own seed mix. Since I don't have experience doing this, I'll just say that reading The Scuttling Gourmet can help you design a good and nutritionally complete seed mix, and if you are in the UK, you might also consider looking into the Rat Rations website, as they are known for their good seed mixes. Now while a good lab block or seed mix should make up the bulk of your rat's diet, you still want to give them more variety with some fun treat foods. One good way to do this is to give fruits and veggies several times a week, along with other foods like Cheerios or Gerber Puffs, which make ideal taming and training treats. Good other treats to offer are occasional bits of meat, pasta, other protein foods like cooked eggs, cooked beans, or meat baby food, plain yogurt, and basically anything that's safe for rats to consume. Keep the fruit and other sugary items to a minimum though, as like other animals, rats will often choose to overeat sweet things. Same goes for protein and fat-filled foods such as cheese and cooked eggs, as especially once your rats are nearing 6 months, they no longer need the extra protein and too much can cause skin and kidney problems. I also want to make a quick note on water here. The majority of rat owners seem to give water to their rats by using your typical pet store water bottle. I give my rats the majority of their water this way as well, as I feel it's the best way to prevent the water from evaporating, leaking out, or being contaminated. Water bowls tend to be covered up by rats with bedding, so they only really work in fleece cages or when mounted to the cage bars. Personally, I do also give my rats a water bowl option. However, unlike normal bowls, my water bowl is actually meant for birds, and it has a hood to prevent contamination, and it also mounts to the cage bars. If you decide to use a water bowl or simply want to give your rats some variety when it comes to water, I suggest using a bar-mounted bird water bowl like I do to prevent contamination and mess. No matter if you decide to use a water bowl, water bottle, or a combination of both, you will always want to provide at least one backup water source. This means that you'll want to have at least two water bottles, bowls, or whatever combo you want to use, even if you only plan on having 2 to 3 rats. For anyone looking for a good quality water bottle, I suggest the Choco No Drip water bottles along with the Oasis Bell Bottle water bottles. As for bird water bowls, the two I'd recommend would be the All Living Things Hooded Bird Feed Cup and the JW Pet Company Water Cup. I will be linking all of these in the description down below, along with links to the lab blocks mentioned above, if you want to look into them. Now let's move on to general health checkups for rats. You may have heard the phrase that prevention is better than cure, and that definitely applies to rats as well. The best way to prevent health issues from spiraling out of control is just to nip them in the bud. And in order to do that, it's a good idea to keep tabs on your rat's weight, behavior, and anything out of the usual, including respiratory noises or any new lumps and bumps that may pop up. I recommend handling your rats each day, even if you can't let them out to play, because this is the easiest way to keep tabs on their physical and mental condition. It's also a good idea to record their weight, at least on a weekly basis, if not more often, because that way you can really tell the small differences, which you might not be able to tell so well just by handling them. And it's nice to have the numbers there so you know that something is going on, and then you can also give that to your vet. Now, signs of a healthy rat to look for include shiny eyes, clear ears, little to no porphyrin, and for those of you who don't know, porphyrin is the rat's red mucus, and you'll often see it on their nose and eyes when they first wake up. Another thing to look for is them having well-groomed fur that isn't thin or puffed out, and a sleek body with no lumps or bumps. Behavior-wise, you want your rats to be curious and active with silent breathing, and they should have their incisors meet right in the middle, and their incisors are their 4 largest front teeth, and it's normal for their lower incisors to be longer than the upper ones, and it's also normal for the lower ones to sometimes splay out in a V, just because rats tend to do that when they're relaxed. Keep in mind that these are more of a general guideline, and the best way to know that your rats are really feeling good is just by spending time with them and getting to know their individual quirks. As for signs of a sick rat, these tend to vary widely. Common signs that your rat may be sick are noisy breathing, especially if the noises seem to start and stop without their control, harsh or abdominal breathing, lethargy, excess porphyrin, gasping, sucking in sides, a head tilt, circling, dull eyes, sneezing, scabs, lumps, and generally anything that seems off about your rat. If your rat does display signs of being sick, the best course of action is to take them to your vet immediately. Rats go downhill very fast, and the quicker you get them diagnosed and treated, the more likely they're going to be able to recover from their illness. Respiratory noises and other breathing issues are something you should pay particular attention to, as rats are quite prone to respiratory illnesses, and these can easily be fatal. When in doubt, it's always better to be safe than sorry and go to the vet. And that brings me to the next topic, which is about vets. Before you get rats, you should know of at least one nearby vet that will examine and treat rats. Ideally, this vet will have prior rat experience and be willing to do more invasive treatments such as surgery on them. I do realize that some people do not have access to such vets though, and so in a pinch, even a typical cat and dog vet can prescribe rat medications. Just be sure to call or visit ahead of time, as some clinics will refuse to treat rats. It's also a good idea to have a vet fund set aside for any medical emergency. For such small and seemingly cheap animals, rats can cost quite a bit when it comes to vet treatment. Depending on your area, a normal rat checkup could vary in cost. Personally, in my area, the cost tends to vary between $25 and $55, depending on which clinic you take your rats to. You also have to take into account that any extra medication, surgeries, or really any extra thing done during the examination is probably going to cost a fair bit more than the initial examination fee. All in all, I'd recommend having at least $100 set aside per rat in case of an emergency, and I'd also recommend calling your local vet clinics while your rats are still healthy so that you know where to go if your rats get ill and have a good idea of what the visit may cost. Before I move on, I want to note a few pointers that can help you when you have a sick rat. To start, if you see any abnormal behavior, it's a good idea to record it. Rats are prey animals, and this means that when you bring them to the vet, they will feel very nervous and try to act normal. And it's hard for a vet to diagnose what they can't see, so it's really helpful if you're able to show them a video of exactly what concerned you so they can get a general idea of what's going on. Another good thing to do is if you have a less rat-experienced vet, you can print out the Rat Health Guide pages for whatever ailment you suspect your rat has. Not all vets will be receptive to reading this, but from my own personal experience, many vets are grateful to have this information on potential treatments that they just might not know about. My previous vet would usually read the page I printed out for her and then do her own research on the suggested treatments including calling up an out-of-state rodent specialist who would help her decide on the best treatment. My current vet is a lot more experienced with rats, so she doesn't need any of this extra help. However, considering how helpful these pages have been to me in the past, I thought it would be a good idea to link them down below in case anyone else is in a similar situation. As for actually caring for your sick rats, my best advice is to not separate them unless absolutely necessary. Rats are very social animals, and it's usually more stressful to separate them than it is to keep them together. Even though many rat illnesses are transmissible to other rats, most of these have an incubation period where they are transmissible but show no symptoms, and so any rats living in the same airspace will have already come into contact with the exact same germs. As such, trying to separate a sick rat away from his or her cage mates is really only something you should do if the rat in question could be potentially harmed by their cage mates or needs extra out-of-home care, such as in the case of needing to stay in an oxygen tank. The only time I've separated sick rats were due to the rat needing to stay at the vet's for something like oxygen, or the rat needing to recover from something like surgery, but they were kind of out of it in the beginning due to their meds, and as such needed a day or two to go back to normal behavior, after which I introduced them back to the group. As for actually giving your rats medicine, this can be somewhat difficult depending on how the medication is flavored and how sick the rat is. Most medications could be mixed in something like Ensure or Meat Baby Food, which the rat will then readily consume. Syringe training, which is where you teach the rat to accept things from a syringe before they are sick by feeding yummy liquid foods this way, is another good strategy. I syringe train all my rats, and it really does help because when they are sick and suspicious of new foods, they are much more likely to accept it through a syringe due to past good experiences. If your rat is sick enough though, or if you're dealing with a particularly gross medication, you might have to force the medication, and while this sucks, it is sometimes necessary. One thing that can be helpful in an emergency is to make a rat first aid kit. I have a fairly extensive first aid kit for my rats that has been useful on numerous occasions, especially for rat emergencies where I didn't have immediate access to my vet. Good things to include in this first aid kit are over-the-counter pain relievers like infant or child's Motrin or Tylenol, cornstarch or styptic powder to stop bleeding, sterile gauze, vet wrap, vet tape, a kitchen scale that weighs in grams, vet spray for any infections or bumblefoot, Benabac, which is a probiotic to be used a few hours after antibiotics to promote good gut flora, soy infant formula, Ensure and or Meat Baby Food to promote eating and staying hydrated while the rat is ill, a snuggle safe, which is basically a heating pad with no cords, sterile syringes, coconut oil, Revolution for parasites, Benadryl for allergy-related issues, nail cutters, just in case you have an older or ill rat that can't keep their nails trim, sterile saline, a clean towel, a one-level sick cage and carrier, the three most common types of antibiotics, which are Baytril, doxycycline, and amoxicillin, and finally, dosing charts for any medication that you have in your kit. Do note that at least in the United States, it is illegal to sell antibiotics for mammals online, and so if you plan on stocking these in your first aid kit, you will need to buy them from a reputable bird or reptile site. I will link where I get mine in the description down below, along with add a link to where I get my Revolution for parasites, as this is also usually a prescription medicine. I know this seems like a lot of stuff, and honestly, you don't need to buy all of this. However, it can be really helpful to have a few of these things just in case of an emergency or a situation where you don't want to wait to get vet care. So for example, when my rats sprain their feet, it's not bad enough to go to the vet. However, it's really helpful to be able to give them an anti-inflammatory and pain med like children's Motrin, because this really helps to speed healing and it makes them a lot less uncomfortable during the process. So yeah, a lot of this stuff here is just really nice to have in case of a situation popping up, but you don't necessarily need it. And even if you do have a full first aid kit like I do here, you still want to have a vet that you can go to because certain things you really don't want to mess with. Okay, so with all that being said, I now want to move on to rat body care. Rats are pretty easy to care for body-wise because they tend to take care of themselves. Rats don't need regular baths, and in fact, you should avoid bathing them unless you really need to. And when I say really need to, I mean that they've gotten into a situation where they shouldn't groom off what they have on, or if they're older and ill or something like that, and they can't groom themselves for some reason. And even in that situation, it's better to use a warm, wet washcloth to wipe them down, as this is a lot less stressful on the rat. Bathing too much can also reduce their fur of natural oils, and this in turn can make them smell worse than normal, so, you know, keep that in mind as well. Adding on to this, unless rats are ill or old, most of them don't really need their nails clipped or filed. However, if you have really fair skin, or if you're just afraid of getting scratched up, then you can clip their nails, and you just have to be really careful about not nicking the quick. Personally, I have never clipped my rat's nails unless they were really old or ill and so couldn't do it themselves. If you want, you can provide your rats with lava ledges or bricks or pumice stones under their water bottles or just in areas they tend to go in a lot, because this can kind of help to naturally wear down the nail. Now, as for their teeth, you might have heard people say that rats need a lot of chew toys because they need to keep their incisors trim. And this isn't really true, because the way that the rats keep their incisors trim is just by bruxing, which is when they rub the upper and lower incisors together. So they don't really need any help keeping their teeth trim. If you give them chew toys, they might chew it, they might not, but it doesn't really matter in the context of keeping their incisors trim. However, if your rat is born with misaligned incisors, which means that the lower and upper incisors don't meet in the middle, then they will have issues, because if the incisors don't meet properly when they get ground together or when the rat chews on things, it's going to wear down the incisors unevenly. So if your rat is born with this, or if they get this due to an illness or some accident causes their incisors to become misaligned, then you will need to take them to the vet to have their incisors clipped or filed down. And potentially you could be taught to do this yourself. I know quite a few people do it themselves in some of the rat groups I'm part of. However, I wouldn't feel comfortable doing it until I got a vet opinion first. And I definitely want to see the vet do it and then have them show me how to do it first, because there is the potential that you could crack a tooth if you did it wrong. So, you know, you need to be really careful. Now, moving on to the next topic, I want to briefly cover taming and handling. So there are a few different methods you can use to tame your rats, including the more forceful method of picking them up regardless of how much they like it, and then the more passive method of letting them come to you. Now, both methods have their place and can be mixed and matched. However, I would advise you to assess your rat's temperaments before committing to one way of taming. The problem with telling you to tame your rats one way or the other is that it depends a lot more on the rat's temperament than anything else. If you have a rat that is naturally outgoing and friendly, then just going in full force and picking them up is probably the best way to speed taming. Even if you have a mildly skittish rat, you can probably get away with just handling them and letting them adjust. However, if you have a rat that is more skittish than that, then you're definitely going to want to take a slower approach. The problem with trying to use this more forceful method on a more skittish rat is that trying to force them to adjust like this can easily backfire, and you can end up with a rat that's even more scared of you than ever before. So if you have a rat that is on the more timid side, my suggestion is that you take taming at a bit of a slower pace, working more on getting your rats to come to you for yummy liquid treats like yogurt, before gradually moving on to touch and handling. Not all rats will tame down the same way, and some may never enjoy handling as much as others. And for these rats, you might want to find other ways of interacting as well, because while you do want them to be tame enough for health checkups and any medical treatment, you don't want to be forcing yourself on them. That doesn't mean you can't still enjoy interacting with them, and in my case, I found my skittish rats are still very receptive to trick training and playing games like chasing strings or straws. It's just that they're less into handling and touch, and that's okay. So moving on to our next topic, now I want to talk about free range. Free ranging your rats just refers to letting them run around in a rat-proof area with your supervision. This area can be a rat-proof room with outlets, cords, and any other dangerous item covered, or it can be something more contained like a table or bed. Another good option if you can't rat-proof an area is to make or buy your own playpen and then use that instead. My free range area is actually a DIY playpen made from cardboard and duct tape, and during free range I Velcro it onto the side of my cage. Since I have quite a few skittish rats currently, I like to give them the option to come and go from their cage during free range pretty much whenever they want. Even my more confident rats really enjoy this, so I like to just give them this option to be able to go back to their cage if they want to or come back out, and it's just nice to make it more up to them. Like I said, I do use a DIY playpen, and my current playpen has lasted me over 2 years, which is really awesome, and it's easy to store and set up at a moment's notice. If you would like to see how I made my playpen, I'm going to go ahead and link that down below, so you can make your own if you want, or just check it out and see what it looks like. And I'm also going to link my preferred commercial playpen for anyone who prefers to go that route. If you do decide to go for a commercial playpen, keep in mind that any fabric ones are probably going to be chewed out of pretty quickly. Personally, I would avoid anything like that, and I just stick to something made out of a solid material like plastic, or something that's made out of, you know, cardboard if you want to DIY it like I did. Don't forget to add a lot of toys and hides to your free range area and to give your rats a lot of time to warm up to it. I find that a lot of rats can act a little bit skittish during their first few play sessions, and this is completely normal. Like I said, they are prey animals by nature, and this means that it can take a little bit longer for them to warm up to a new area. With that being said, they will adjust pretty quickly, and the more they're in the area, the more bold they're going to be in it, and eventually they won't even care about it being an open area because it's just normal for them. They feel very confident there. So yeah, I wouldn't worry too much if they seem scared at first because they definitely will adjust, and you can help them by putting a lot of toys for them to go hide in if they get scared, and just for them to investigate and play with. And then you can also put on a blanket or loose hoodie because this encourages them to come to you because rats really enjoy dark and warm areas quite a bit. I'd also recommend a minimum of 1 to 2 hours of free range several days a week. More is always better, of course, and my rats tend to get around 2 to 4 hours on a daily basis. However, I have occasionally skipped days, and I know not everyone can keep up this sort of schedule, so I just say try to shoot for several days a week where you can give them at least an hour or two of just running around outside of their cage. And the final thing I want to talk about is probably the most fun part about keeping rats, and that's just interacting with them. Some activities that my rats enjoy include things like hand wrestling, and this is where I use my hand to imitate another rat and tickle and flip them over, or something like chasing a string or straw, which is where I drag around a straw or string and they run after it, or something like pea fishing, which is where you can put some frozen peas or other veggies in a shallow bowl of water and your rats will learn to fish it up. You can also do something like trick training, which is something I really enjoy. And this is where you teach your rats lots of fun tricks. Mine know things like fetch, agility, basketball, walking on a barrel, and so forth. And then depending on the rat, you might also be able to cuddle with them or snuggle with them. Keep in mind that each rat does have their own personality, and especially younger rats aren't huge fans of cuddling. Occasionally, you will of course get a younger rat that is very into cuddling, but generally it's something that you see in older rats. So as your rats get up there, they get over a year or over a year and a half, then you can usually start to see which ones will become cuddly. And I find that the rats that are friendly generally from the beginning do tend to become cuddly as they get older. So don't lose hope if your young rats are just crazy, because that's completely normal. Don't be afraid to experiment with a few different things to see what you and the rats can enjoy together. Okay, so now that I've gone over all these basics, I thought I'd wrap up this video by going over cost. I did some calculations using some general prices for each product, and the budget I came up with was $185 to $490 for initial rat cost, and this would be for about 2 to 4 rats, and that is without a vet fund. If you add in the vet fund, it would be $335 to $690. Now, I'm not going to say exactly what items and what their prices are out loud here, but I'm going to have a chart on the screen that you can look at to see where I'm getting my numbers from. Now, don't forget that you can save quite a bit of money by buying your cage secondhand, making your toys, buying them from the Dollar Tree, buying them from Goodwill. There's a lot of options out there to save money on rats, honestly. You can also do things like buying food and bedding in bulk, especially online. And this is something that I do, especially now that I have a larger number of rats, and it's really helpful and can save you quite a bit. Okay, so that's pretty much it for this video, and I hope you guys enjoyed. Thank you guys for watching, and I know this is a lot of info, so if anyone has questions, feel free to comment them down below. So yeah, I will see you guys later, and that's it. Bye!